run you through the housekeeping rules for this evening. So I'm Andrew Rummer. I'm part of the analyst team here at Finimize. How it's going to work tonight? We have two expert founders. I'm excited to introduce them. We have Will Stringer, who is one of the co-founders and CEO at Chisos. Chisos writes checks for somewhere between $15,000 and $50,000 to invest in early stage startups. These are the kind of companies that perhaps aren't right for venture capital. Perhaps they don't qualify for bank loans. And for those businesses that are in that gap in the market, Chisos is there. Our second founder is Troy Carter, co-founder and CEO at Rhizome. And Troy and his team are bringing scale and vision to the planet's ecological and climate crisis. And Rhizome is pioneering bamboo-engineered lumber to pull carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and improve the construction industry. So this evening, well, I keep saying this evening. It's this evening here in London. It may be somewhere else, wherever you are in the world. We love to see where you're dialing in from. We have a nice little chat box here on the side of Zoom. Put your name in, put where you're dialing in from. Make sure you switch it from two hosts and panelists to everyone so we can see. It's always cool to see how many people dialed in. You know, are you from, I don't know, are you in India, in the US? Where are you coming from? We have people all over the world. It's great to see. Let us know where you are there. Oh, Mohammed from London. That's great to see you, Mohammed. So we will be doing 15 minutes of conversation, 15 minutes of questions from me to our two founders, followed by roughly 15 minutes of audience Q&A. So now you may have discovered the chat box in Zoom. I'm going to direct you to a totally different box. Go to the Q&A box along the bottom of the panel in Zoom. Q&A, you can open that up. You can ask your questions of these two founders. You can see other people's questions in there. You can upvote other people's questions if you think they're cool. Hi, Livin from Florida. Hi, Steve from the Virgin Islands. Amazing. Amazing. Virgin Islands. Awesome. So I will get going with my questions to our two co-founders. Have 5 or 6 minutes each and then open up to all of you. So just another final reminder, put your questions in the Q&A. Now, first of all, we're going to hear from Will Stringer, co-founder and CEO at Chisos. So, you know, what is Chisos? Give us a bit quick pitch.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks, Andrew. So Chisos, again, my name is Will Stringer, co-founder, CEO of Chisos. And Chisos is alternative capital for founders. So if you think about starting a business, think about spending, you know, 5-10K of your own money to really get the basics in place. Incorporate, get a few no-code tools in place. Now you realize you need another 30 or 50 to build the MVP, gain some traction, raise a round from angels. Well, today, where's this money going to come from if you don't have that wealthy friends and family network to write those very early stage checks? That's where Chisos is coming in. So Chisos created something called a convertible income share agreement, which combines an income share agreement with the founder and a safe with the business in order to provide that capital. So this CISA provides de-risk downside for investors and uncapped upside for investors as well. And for the entrepreneur, it gives them the ability to raise pre-traction by utilizing their future earning potential. So essentially, we're kind of acting as friends and family capital. So friends and family, when they invest, they get comfortable with the person through their long-term relationship with that person. Well, what we've done is kind of shortcutted that process by looking at their opportunity as a whole. What has this person accomplished? What does their financial health look like? What does their business idea look like? Our terms are flexible, founder-friendly, less dilutive than other capital sources, and more flexible than credit cards or bank loans. So in the US, at least 83% of new businesses are failed by existing funding options. Even though all the VC investments get all the news and headlines, really less than 1% of companies receive VC funding. And then on the other side, less than 16% of companies receive bank funding. So there's this huge gap in the middle, which we are attempting to fill with small checks to early stage founders. So our business and what's kind of the opportunity here. So we're raising $1 million to build out our team and build out our continue building out our platform. What our platform does is efficiently source, underwrite, and service these investments. So we have an open application. We get applicants from all over today, the United States. We underwrite those kind of automatically on the front end and then take a look manually on the back end at the business and then write the check, deploy that capital, and more importantly, support those founders as they grow their business by making introductions to investors, mentors, advisors, other service providers. And so we make money by deploying that capital and then supporting those founders and servicing those opportunities. And we've done this at a smaller scale today. We've deployed $500,000. We have 13 investments across the United States, a diverse mix, female, male founders, 50% minority founders. So we're deploying capital and it's working. And we have a number of those companies that have raised up rounds, a number of those entrepreneurs that have actually made ISA payments back. So it is working. Now we're looking to scale.
I've done this with a few different companies. I think it's interesting because we've had various companies pitch, but I've never had a company pitching that is also themselves an investor. So I guess most of the time this must be the other way around for you, in that you're the one receiving appeals for money, but this time you're the one pitching to us for money. So that's really fascinating. So I cut you off briefly, but what are the biggest challenges you're trying to overcome at the moment? And I guess what's the opportunity down the road if everything goes to plan?
Yeah, our challenges we're looking at right now, a lot of it is education. So because we have this, call it machine, that we raise capital or we find capital pools, we then source the opportunities, underwrite them, and deploy that capital. It's education on both sides. Education for investors to say, hey, this is what you're investing in. This is how your downside's protected. This is how you get exposure to tons of startup companies. And then for the entrepreneurs looking to raise capital, it's, hey, this is a unique investment. It's not a bank loan or credit card. It's not a pure angel investment. Here's how it works. So getting everybody comfortable with that is really what we're working on right now with putting out a lot of materials. To your second question on the opportunity, again, it's buying into really the parent company. So, it's not a fund. We are raising some funds, but the opportunity is to invest in parent company that manages those funds and that receives all the benefit of any underlying successes in those companies. So one investment, exposure to thousands of companies eventually at scale.
Awesome. Thank you. I think we should move on to our second pitch from Troy before we run out of too much time. Just another reminder, if you've got questions for either Will or Troy, put them in that Q&A box down at the bottom of your Zoom window. Troy, tell us about Rhizome. Is that pronounced right? And what is this company? What are you trying to do with Rhizome?
Yeah. So Rhizome is pioneering the use of bamboo engineered lumber with a couple goals. The first is to sequester more than 10 gigatons of carbon by 2050, and also make bamboo engineered lumber a primary global construction material to replace wood, steel, and concrete. So I probably don't need to convince anyone on this webinar that climate change is real. We need to decarbonize the built environment, and we need to stop deforestation and implement scalable solutions to ecological collapse. So Rhizome is a great example of a compelling business case, a superior material, cheaper and more sustainable. So what we make right now is basically quarter inch plywood. And in our goal is that it's the cheapest, highest quality quarter inch plywood in the world. And that is a scalable input into pretty much every single building and construction use on earth. So we built our first factory in 2019. We're building our second factory right now, both in the Philippines. And we're also in the process of doing large scale reforestation and planting both in the Philippines and in Florida. And just on the business case, it turns out planting bamboo and trees is actually really profitable. You can sell a ton of carbon credits. So we just signed a contract with Climate Care for a $28 million carbon credit sale from reforestation activities in the Philippines. We're working on another deal for Florida. So just on the planting, it's super profitable, and we get to stop deforestation and implement sustainable agroforestry crops. And on the manufacturing side, it's also really compelling. The reason we're raising $1 million through crowdfunding, honestly, it's mostly marketing. We have a lot of institutional and other backing for expanding manufacturing, doing project finance for expanding manufacturing and also planting. We also are working with USAID for grant money. So it's really a way to engage everyone who wants to invest in a meaningful way to contribute to the climate crisis and have big impact on the built environment. We're actually using $1 million directly. It goes into machinery for our Philippines operation, and part of that is used for planting operations as well. So yeah, invest if you want to have a big impact on the planet, if you want to be part of a really profitable, new building material that can replace wood, steel, and concrete. And also if you have particular interest in the Philippines, in Florida, or maybe another country that you're a part of, if you're a large landowner or have other strategic partnerships, we have a pretty aggressive planting operation and the sense that regional bamboo economies need to exist all around equatorial regions of the world. And in 10 years, it'll be super obvious that this was coming. And right now we're pioneering the technology, the processes and implementing to actually make that reality super obvious.
So when people do this carbon offset schemes, like if I'm booking a flight somewhere and I like check the box that says I want to pay a bit extra to like offset the carbon for my flight, is some of that money going to you? Is that what you mean about those the funds you were talking about?
Yep. So the carbon credits that we sell, honestly, very few of them will go to individuals just because the volume isn't large. Most of these go to very large voluntary corporate clients. Examples include Microsoft, Chevron, oil companies, industrial companies, technology companies, Google, et cetera. Although we're actually using a broker to sell through.
Why is bamboo better than just using wood? That was the question I had after watching all your pitch.
That's a great question. There's a few key features. One, bamboo grows really fast, which means you can use a much smaller amount of land area for the same amount of building materials. And so it's around a 10 to 1 ratio. You need 10 times as much Douglas fir under management and only 1 acre per 10 acres for bamboo. So that's really great. So stopping deforestation and land use conversion. Another is that it's a technically superior material. So it's super strong and fire resistant and super durable. So actually the building material itself is way better than existing wood alternatives. And it's also cheap because it grows so fast and the manufacturing process that we've developed, last year it was much more expensive. And in previous years, using smaller types of bamboo, it's much more expensive, but now we're actually price competitive with other structural wood products. And in a couple of years, it'll be much cheaper. The global supply of wood is going down. And so inevitably bamboo is going to overtake wood in terms of price, in terms of quality, in terms of sustainability.
Final question for me, then I'll open it up to Q&A from the audience for both of you. As I said, for everyone out there in the audience, just put your questions in there. I see a couple in at the moment. Oh, a third one just popped in. Brilliant. Fire questions in there. So Troy, what are the challenges that you face at the moment in scaling this business and getting where you want to be? And then a few years down the line, what could this look like?
Yeah. The biggest challenge over the last couple of years has been COVID. Travel throughout Southeast Asia, shipping equipment from Taiwan and China. Honestly, COVID has been a big slowdown for us in terms of manufacturing. However, it's also, the last 2 years, lumber prices have gone up 400%. Global lumber supply has gone way down. So actually the market demand is absolutely absolutely overwhelming. There's no way we can keep up with our customer demand. So it's really about scaling up production. That's also why we're implementing production facilities and planting in Florida, so we can bring it closer to home for North American customers. So it's really, we need to scale production, and that's a combination of expanding the team, expanding financing opportunities, and diversifying countries.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much to Troy and Will for your super brief pitches. I know it's tightly, you know, your business is both do so many different things, so I'm sure it's really difficult to like keep it down to such a tight time, but thank you so much. We will open it up to questions coming in from the audience right now. Steve asks, I'm assuming this question from Steve is directed towards Will, I assume. He says, do you ask for equity or are you looking for a loan repayment? I assume this is with the investments that Chisos is making.
Yeah, good question. So it's a bit of both, honestly. So we get equity in the business, and then this income share agreement, while not a credit instrument, requires payback from the founder in certain situations, but they are a little bit of a seesaw. So when you make payments on the income share agreement, you're actually clawing back your equity. And then if you have some success on the business side of things, you actually reduce that income share agreement. So a little bit of both, and that's why it's kind of flexible and usable in that earliest stage.
Awesome. Gemma has a really broad question. I like this. I guess to both of you, maybe we could start with Troy, but what are the lessons you've learned from your crowdfunding campaign so far?
Troy, you want to kick it off?
I don't know. What lessons have we learned? I think maybe underlying this is that myself and the rest of our team, we have a deep belief in sort of stakeholder capitalism or in spreading the wealth distribution very widely. And so crowdfunding is right now pretty much the only way to get a whole bunch of different investors on the cap table. And honestly, I wish there was an easier way that we could just have an open equity structure so that anyone around the world can invest and participate in upside of really great companies. And SEC makes it a little bit challenging. So I'm really glad crowdfunding limits have been raised to $5 million. There's a lot of like really successful companies I know now that are raising $5 million rounds just to be able to bring more people into the story. Because it's not like we're not trying to do all the value capture ourselves. Like we want our customers engaged. We want our suppliers engaged. So it's really a great way to invest and actually be a partner in the business and be an advocate and be a salesperson and participate in something that we really believe in, which is ecological regeneration and decarbonization of the built environment and solving climate change.
Awesome. What about you, Will?
Yeah, pretty similar. You know, we're trying to bring in a community of people passionate about early stage companies. It's, you know, it's a community game to get a early stage company from idea to, you know, IPO. And the more people that we can bring into our ecosystem, we think that improves the odds. We can send out an email to all of our investors and say, hey, you know, this company is looking to hire, you know, this type of person. We've done that 3 times already, and we've gotten inbound recommendations for new hires. So the more people we have kind of within our ecosystem, we think it improves the odds of success.
Very cool. Mohammed has a question just for you, Will. What are the key things you're looking for in a team when you're deciding whether or not to invest in their company?
Good question. Yeah. So 3 buckets that we look at, and 2 are founder oriented. 1 is business oriented. So 2 on the founder. So we do look at their financial health picture, different credit, different debt to income ratios. We do look at more qualitative and psychographic information. So things like, do they have the leadership, grit, ambition, hustle to be an entrepreneur and founder? And then kind of understand, hey, what's their career? What's their education? Those types of things. And then lastly, we do look at the business, much like a venture capitalist would look at the business. Obviously, there's not much there at that early stage. So we just try to get a sense of, have they deeply thought about their customer, their problem they're trying to solve, their go-to-market strategy, and those types of things. And we really look at the whole picture of all of those buckets when making a decision.
Thanks. Another question for both of you, I guess, from the mysterious N. I may have missed this, but how liquid would our investments be with either Rhizome or Chizos? What are the investment terms? I don't know. Are you able to talk about these at all?
I can give a broad strokes. So one, we currently have a crowdfunding campaign up on WeFunder. We've raised more than $1 million so far. Actually, the campaign on WeFunder will probably close in about 2 weeks. So now is the last opportunity to get in. The terms, it's a convertible note. And so honestly, it's not super liquid at this point. You will be investing in for a multi-year ride until there's a liquidity event, the shares convert into equity, and then either through a secondary market or participating in a future liquidity event or acquisition or IPO, on the order of years.
I see my colleague Michelle has just pasted a link to Rhizome's WeFunder campaign there if you want to check it out. How about Will? Is it similar for you?
Very similar. Yep. It's a convertible note, not super liquid. We hope to, down the line, make distributions or face an acquisition or an IPO at some point. One feature, it is 6% on that convertible note. So over 2 years while you hold that note, if you've invested $1,000, after 2 years, you'll end up with $1,120 worth of equity in the company. So yeah, it's a convertible note.
Awesome. There's a question here from Steve, which I'm assuming is just for Troy. The bamboo products that you're producing, do you foresee producing more than just this quarter inch plywood?
Yeah, absolutely. Honestly, we're pretty swamped by demand right now. We can go sell exactly what we're making for the next 5 to 10 years and not have to make anything else. Obviously, in the future, if we're going to replace wood, steel, and concrete at a scalable level that's meaningful for the construction industry as a whole, we're going to need to expand production massively for like thousands of times more than what we're doing now. And so then we'll, make beams, make CLT, make LVL, other engineered wood products. But for now, there's something about really precise focus and doing one thing the best in the world that gives a lot of momentum and precision and scalability to what we're doing. And it's also, it's not available at retailers. Like, you can't go to Lowe's and Home Depot right now. It all goes to wood distributors for things like door and windows and other high-end uses. But over the course of 2022, as we expand production, we will start opening up to retailers.
Awesome. I think that may have also accidentally answered one of these questions from Mary Louise that she had about your distribution chain. So that's good. Thank you. Mary Louise also has two questions for Will. One asking kind of gets more details on this. The investments, restrictions. She said, are there any time limits to the convertible share agreements? And relatedly, she asks, can you be both an investor in and a client of Chisos?
Yeah, so I'll take those in reverse order. Yes, anybody accredited, non-accredited can invest in Chisos as little as $100. And you'll be part of the community, exposure to those thousands of companies. You can also be an entrepreneur looking to raise capital from us. So if you go to our website, there's a big orange box that says apply now, and you provide some information to get that started. And we'll reach out and put you through the diligence process if you hit certain criteria. So yes, on the time limit side of it. So the income share agreement, if you've kind of look in the education space, this is where they're being used quite a bit. And ours is very similar. It says, there's an amount cap on the payback, there's a time cap on the payback. And what's unique about ours is a lot of that, the amount cap can come down if you have business success. So there is, caps on payback, caps on time on that income share agreement.
Awesome. I think we're coming to the end of our list of questions here. Am I missing any here? Oh, Dante wants to know what camera you're using, Will. Apparently your camera and background look really high quality. And anything's fancy there, or is it just like a MacBook or something like that?
It's a MacBook with the blur on.
Good. Well, it's impressed Dante, so that's good. I'm sorry. I feel my background's not very interesting, obviously. That's great. So yeah, my colleague Michelle has been putting the links in for those two crowdfunding campaigns. Hopefully you can see them. Hopefully they haven't got lost. Maybe Michelle could just post them one more time for everyone. There's WeFunder pages for Rhizome and Chisos. If you want to go and invest, any final pitch? Maybe you can go first, Troy, because you went last time. What's your final 1 minute pitch and a reminder where people can go if they do want to invest?
Totally. So for everyone on this call, go to wefunder.com/rhizome. Invest in as little as 100 or as much as you want. If you're an accredited investor or large landowner or potential operator in Florida or an equatorial region around the world, you know, give us a call. We're always open to new partnerships. Also, if you're project finance person or connecting with multilateral institutions, also give us a call. But broadly, this is both an impact investment and a really profitable investment. We're going to help restore global ecology, implement sustainable building systems, and become a really big successful business as we're doing that, to scale to more than 1,000 factories around the world in order to sequester 10 gigatons of carbon. So thanks for considering us.
Thanks so much. Your final pitch, Will?
Yeah, thanks everybody for joining. Similarly, wefunder.com/Chisos. If you're interested in early stage companies and entrepreneurs, we involve our investors. We involve our community because it helps us help those founders grow their business. So if you're interested in kind of that exposure and helping out these early stage companies, come invest. Also, if you're interested in kind of new types of capital options and democratizing that entrepreneurship, that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to provide those small checks to those entrepreneurs that don't otherwise have good access to get a company started. So in that form, democratizing entrepreneurship and helping people start companies. So again, wefunder.com/Chisos. Would love to have you involved.
Fantastic. Thank you very much to Troy Carter of Rhizome and Will Stringer of Chisos. We're wrapping up just about on time. We always like to be punctual here at Finomize. Go about your day wherever you are in the world. Have a great evening, have a great morning wherever you are. And thank you so much. Hope to see you all again at the next fantastic Finomize event.
Thanks, Andrew.